On the 6th of September, Prince William arrived for the first day at his new school. While the subject of obsessive interest from the media, little is actually known about the influences that have shaped his life to date. The importance of the next 5 years is unequivocal. School is the time when boys mature into men and knowledge becomes understanding. It is a place from which he will come to know not only his school fellows, but also his fellow countrymen, and which will provide a perspective for his view of the world. This film looks at the kind of education he is likely to receive there, and the influences and the ideas he will encounter. And it estimates his chances of emerging from Eton with the confidence, the character, and the powers of judgment that he will need to be a popular monarch and an effective one for the British people in the 21st century. Although it is one of our oldest schools, Eton would claim it has a bias to the future and not to the past. Yet it is impossible, wandering its courtyards and cloisters, to escape completely from the presence of the past. Inspired by the example of Winchester, the saintly King Henry VI founded the College of Eton on the meadows across the river from Windsor Castle to educate 70 scholars. Its chapel was designed to be a centre of pilgrimage, and together with King's College, Cambridge, it represents the lasting achievement of his reign. The legacy of its famous past lives on in the names of old boys and battles that line the walls of its cloisters and chapel. Their portraits given to the school as leaving gifts stare down from every room. Their names etched on marble plaques and carved deep into the wood and stone. It is this accumulation of time, old boys and buildings that forms the stable ground of tradition from which Eton looks to the future. And while the average boy would disclaim any interest in it, it is continually and eagerly renewed. On May the 7th this year, the boys and masters gathered in schoolyard for a VE Day remembrance service.
D, E and F on that side. It's F at the front, E in the middle, D at the back.
Above the school office flew the college's standard, bearing the emblems of Henry VI's two kingdoms, England and France. The 70 scholars, still supported by the income of largely medieval endowments, glide through the mass of ordinary boys or oppidans in white surplices. The foundation that controls the endowments is headed by the provost, wearing the red robes of an honorary doctor. He is accompanied by the vice provost, the headmaster, the conduct, who is the senior chaplain, and their wives. In his speech, the provost, a crown appointment since the time of the founder, reminds the present generation of Etonians of the sacrifices made by their predecessors.
Bronze tablets under this arcade behind it record the names of no less than 1,157 old Etonians who were killed in the First World War and 749 who were killed in the Second World War. Eton's losses were in percentage terms probably higher than any other institution in the country. I now ask the captain of the school on behalf of the foundation and the captain of the oppidans on behalf of the school to lay wreaths, and this will be followed by a minute's silence.
Dr. Andrew Gailey, who will be Prince William's housemaster, is an historian.
This is of the Duke of Wellington, famous, of course, for Waterloo, who was a boy in this house. And I have one or two French parents who rather dislike his prominent position. And I did manage to dig out a model of Napoleon, suitably small, I think.
Some people may think that Eton is a very hidebound, traditional place in the negative sort of way, and they look at the uniforms and they look at various rituals and they assume it's lost in a past. But actually, it's a place that's naturally very dynamic because the young are not instinctively traditional. For them, anything is possible, anything can be changed. And consequently, it's vital that they have roots with which they can change from. They've got to know where they came from to know where they're going to. And tradition is the vital mechanism for this.
In fact, tradition is more evident in the superficialities of life at Eton than in its underlying realities. Both masters and boys dress in the white tie and tails of a century ago. The argot they use, of divs and dames, pop and debate, is equally out of date.
Beaks and masters, they wear waistcoats with collars, but they wear bow ties. They do actually have a uniform, which is quite nice, actually.
Many less amusing Etonian traditions have been allowed to die. Beatings are now a thing of the past. Fagging, in which younger boys act as unpaid servants to the older boys, has disappeared. But much of the ancient regime still survives. Everybody boards, there are no girls, games matter. It is more interested in being modern than in looking modern. It has to be.
Any system which is going to keep going has to be open, a system, and has to be constantly changing if it's going to survive. And not only survive, but keep its position in the world. And what we're talking about, the position of Eton, of course, we're talking about striving for excellence, which is a word easy to bandy around. But excellence in a whole series of areas.
Only 1% of Etonians fail an A-level.
This remarkable record of success reflects the transition to a more meritocratic entry system where boys win a place at Eton by means of a competitive written examination and a demanding interview.
The last point of change was, I think, sometime in the 60s, early 70s. And I always feel that that was the change from the Eton of the established upper middle class gentrified background to something much more like other schools, meritocratic, intellectually demanding, and carrying a whole series of other things on the side, carrying its traditional background on the side, carrying its sporting prowess on the side, carrying its curious festivities and fatuous clothes on the side. But the change there was to a school that would be first among equals academically, and in other words, delivering the modern product.
Ironically, competitive entrance has probably made Eton more elitist than ever. The increase in demand for private education has reinforced its exclusivity. Choosing boys solely on merit rather than on class or family has also diluted its heterogeneity. Although there are still families with strong traditional links with Eton, the Wellesleys have been going there for 8 successive generations following the first Duke of Wellington.
The first Duke's elder brother, Lord Wellesley, was a passionate old Etonian, was a fellow, and indeed is buried in College Chapel.
I believe at the entrance to the north door.
I think that's right, yes.
So that the boys walk over him.
Every day.
Ian McKinnon was the lower master at Eton and is now headmaster of a school in Wellington, New Zealand. He thinks character matters more than background at Eton today, whether you are the son of a publican or a prince.
Commitment's quite a big factor at Eton, commitment to doing well in some, if not many, areas. And boys might come from quite humble backgrounds, but they can still work their way through that system quite effectively. Boys, on the other hand, might come from very distinguished backgrounds and work their way through quite effectively. But if a boy, by the nature of his personality or character, to put it bluntly, rubs people up the wrong way, I don't think it matters a damn what part of that social vertical social area he comes from, you know, he won't be as well accepted as he might otherwise be.
One thing that has not changed is that Eton remains a male-dominated society.
As far as the criticism about it being single-sex is concerned, I think that's much more difficult because it's a trade-off between, you know, how good do you want your A-level results to be or how many girls do you want your sons to know. And we haven't worked that one out. The question is whether the boys would be actually better in their relationships with each other and with the opposite sex if they had girls alongside them all the time. It's a difficult question. Nobody seems to have got a satisfactory answer. It's not clear to me that co-educational schools uniformly produce better husbands, fathers, managers, governors than single-sex schools do. So why is there the certainty that the other will work?
The only women Prince William will regularly encounter at Eton are the dames. The house matrons responsible for looking after his physical needs and personal well-being. And the female beaks. It is working women and not the traditional wife and mother that some see as the important role model for the modern Etonian.
When they come into this lab, they don't see me as a woman, they see me as a physics beak. It's much more odd for some of the beaks and some of the boys' fathers. They react to women beaks much more oddly. They say things like, we didn't have women when we were at school. And so they see you first as a woman and second as you're doing your job. So what I'm saying is that the roles that women do that boys see aren't authoritative roles. But when they come across women in authoritative roles, they treat them as normal beaks.
If we're going to carry through the philosophy that the school now seems to be offering its boys, because what the boys still do need are good female role models.
Most of the boys would prefer females to female role models. They certainly get few opportunities to meet them which are not out of bounds. One of the few opportunities for boys to work with women is in the school theatre. There are three theatres which present up to 15 plays a year. Often productions can involve up to 100 people, as in this year's production of Guys and Dolls. Girls from neighbouring schools take part. Backstage, the cast of Guys and Dolls remain just boys and girls. The powder is applied, microphones fitted, cues checked, and we are reminded that for some, I've never been in love before, is unerringly true. While there may be plays, work is never far away.
What do you see as the immediate pressures when they arrive?
Work, without any doubt. I think the workload just jumps straight up. And some of them definitely struggle with that. Some of the slur boys struggle with that a lot. Mm. They get behind with work. Their work is, you know, poor quality to the standard of work that beaks would expect. And I think they really are surprised by the amount of hours they're meant to sit down and put in.
The first thing new boys have to master is the bewildering organisation and geography of the school and the ruthless segmentation of the school day, in which a boy may be in the top div for history and the bottom div for maths.
Well, finding your way around the school is actually quite difficult because from some places it takes 5 minutes or more to walk to another lesson.
The school covers an area of 2 square miles and has a total population of 3,500 boys, beaks and staff. Nothing demonstrates the sheer size of the place more than the washing the laundry handles each week.
They do about 60 to 80,000 pieces a week, which is basically anything from a boys' rugby shorts right away through to bed linen and master's collars and boys' collars.
The 1,265 boys at the school are scattered across 25 houses of roughly 50 pupils apiece. The houses are divided into a private side occupied by a housemaster and a public side occupied by the boys.
Morning, sir.
The day begins with breakfast in the house, followed by chapel. Then come the first lessons, known as divs.
Divs are classes, divisions, really, because they're all divided up.
Right.
So if you're bad at maths, but good at something like Latin, you're not in the same class all the way through.
They have to be at every lesson on time. They're changing from a formal sort of school dress to perhaps formal change. And if they want to wear their own clothes, they can do that. But they always have to sort of be wearing the right thing at the right time.
There is no bell to help the boys get from one div to the next. They're expected from the outset to organize their own working day.
You look after your own timetable, don't you? There aren't any bells.
No, there are no bells. Well, there is a chapel bell. that is the chapel bell.
Punctuality is an essential part of life at Eton.
They rush in here sometimes. I'm sorry, I'm late, man. You're on tidy book.
I was 2 minutes late for a reading school, and I'd just come back from High Street, and I was over there. Just by opening a Batwell, it was the office waiting for me, and I was set 300 lines of Paradise Lost. She took me about 4 hours.
I would say it's a very pressurised atmosphere. I mean, there are times when I think, what am I achieving? Probably more than the average, you know, I think that more than, imagine the average schoolboy would think because of the hothouse atmosphere of the school.
And I find if I'm not in a hothouse atmosphere, if I'm not being pressurised to do well, I find I'm a bit of a vacuum in a way.
Learning to cope with the pressure does have a positive advantage that when they do leave, boys tend to cope with the greater pressures of the outside world more easily. The small boarding houses are instrumental in allowing the boys a chance to relax. Here, they find time to watch television, play snooker, or catch up with some phone calls, the house telephone being its most valuable asset. Each afternoon, they meet in small groups for messing tea. Houses often produce their own plays or films and celebrate their sporting victories with a house supper. Leo has made a candid camera-type film of boys in the house, which he shows during a house society supper.
Here it is. It's called A Day in the Life of Somebody from Durnford House.
You don't want to come here. Absolute mess. It smells too.
Kept an eye on all the smokers, drinkers, and gamblers in the house.
Yeah, well, he's had a very good week at Cheltenham.
On summer evenings, music issues from every window, and boys find time to rag around.
Thank you.
got to get away from the school life sometimes, all the work and stuff. And it improves as you go up. There's a lot more work as you go further up the school. So you need to get away sometimes. You need to get away and relax. And coming here, in this house, is like more like a home atmosphere than anywhere else.
Because you come to his house and you eat with him. Mr. Bristol and his wife has asked us to eat with him about real dinner for about four times. And they cook very nice meals. And you just feel so much more at ease, and you feel it's so nice to be able to talk to someone. Yeah. And if you don't like a beak, you can tell your tutor. And if you're not getting on in class, you can tell your tutor.
When I was at school, the relationships between boys and masters were very much more formal than it is now. But I think we're in danger of being a bit overprotective at the moment. We're asking people to come in really quite early in the evening and sign out when they go out and that sort of thing. I think we're a tiny bit overprotective.
This curious mixture of formality and informality between boys and beaks sometimes confuses the new boys.
I was coming back from the Beckington schools and I saw a beak who often teaches me, who'd been teaching me Latin. And I said, good evening, sir, how are you? And he looked at me and said, and this, I had just started, and he said, do you normally ask someone how they are at the end of a working day? So I'm very sorry, sir, I was only trying to be polite. And he says, oh, yes, yes, I quite understand your intention. However, it is rather rude to ask this. And I went very red and said, I'm very sorry about that, sir. I'll try not to do it again. And he says, very good, then. Good day to you. And walked away, and I just thought, oh, dear.
Benedictus benedicat.
The school has 18 kitchens, which serve over 4,600 meals a day. Half the boys eat in their houses, where lunch is presided over by the housemaster, while the remainder eat in a cafeteria. The exception to this are Henry's 70 scholars, who dine in the 15th century college dining hall. Their food is prepared below in a kitchen which has been in continuous use since 1440.
I believe this is one of the oldest working kitchens in the country, yes. They used to cook on the grill and the smoke used to go escape that way. Then they built the spits in 1736, which was quite a modern invention then days, because it was automatic spit that used to turn itself on a lead weight and a spring. The boys love, obviously, sausage, egg, chips, beans, like any boy does. But they also like the lasagnas, the chicken tikka masalas. They like being adventurous. I think the 20th century has seen the major change. I mean, if you go in a pub 20 years ago, you're lucky you get a cheese roll, was you? Nowadays, you can get a selection of food. It's the same as here.
So 20 years. No longer school dinners?
I don't think so, no. I think we get to a standard of a four-star hotel at times. We're aiming for five-star. And the Michelin star.
Keep going.
Not only has the food become more liberal, but so too have institutions like POP. Originally made up of 25 senior boys, it was for centuries a harsh and self-elected oligarchy, which until the 1970s had the power to beat and to fine their fellow pupils. In its modern and more open form, it continues to do a useful job and is still a sign of social success within the school. The badge of membership is a gaily coloured waistcoat.
I enjoy these sort of small customs we see, which are unusual. You know, the way they line up at 11 o'clock to meet the masters out on the road there. And when you see somebody from Park or from Debate walking along in this slightly different uniform. I don't get the impression in the house that it's hidebound by any tradition. I think there's an awareness of the tradition. But you must remember, I mean, I just clean the lavatories.
Other traditions have almost died out. The wall game has been played for 250 years and was something held dear by old Etonian fathers and housemasters who in turn inspired their boys. With the number of old Etonian sons now down to under 30% and fewer old boy housemasters, the war game was, until recently, in decline.
The interpretation is a problem, yes. You have to have played it to make much sense of rules.
The truth of this observation becomes evident as soon as the players are asked to explain the rules.
Well, you start off under the ladder up there. Well, there used to be a ladder. And you get a man on the ball who kneels on it. And you can't use your hands. And you can't pull it back, which is called foot. And if you do that, then that's a 10-metre offence. So, obviously, you don't want to do that because 10 metres is a long way.
There was a danger, I think, that the game might have faded away altogether. But we've got it going again, which is terrific.
The housemaster and his dame act in loco parentis to the boys in their care. For the most part, they encounter the same problems: homesickness, examination nerves, divorce, and occasionally bereavement.
I think boys are very good at being nice to those who are in a state. And it's quite interesting, for example, I had last year one or two people whose names were all over the press. And it was very interesting, I thought, how they didn't seem to get any stick at all from the people in the house, nor, I think, from people in the rest of the school, as though their parents' lives and their lives were somehow different and the two didn't impinge. And I think that's one of the great strengths of this place, that you can... Of course, we've got lots of these famous people, children, but once they're in the school environment, that doesn't seem to matter. They're just Fred, Joe, John, etc.
How do the boys react when someone's expelled?
On the whole, they act rather tribally and try to defend what the person has done. They're terrible occasions. They're really harrowing. I remember one time we were all in tears. I was in tears, my dame was in tears, the boys were in tears. It was quite awful. It's very traumatic.
And do they lobby you?
Well, it's all done by then. There's no point in lobbying me. It's all over. Yeah, well, the school takes quite a strong line on some things. I suppose the most obvious is drugs. We'd be daft to think that there were no drugs in here. There are from time to time, I'm sure. But when they are found out, the consequences are quite serious.
I come from a council estate, and I'm working class, and our kids get a lot more freedom. I'm amazed at how disciplined these boys are, and in fact the lack of freedom, because there's always someone watching them. They're always, in a sense, being supervised, maybe not directly, but there's always the... they're always well aware of the fact that even when they're in the road, masters can see them, staff can see them, and it will be commented on.
But do you think they're being watched in a kindly way, or do you think they're having the scruff of their neck held?
Oh, no, I think it's if you like a benevolent deity.
Discipline is largely self-maintained, and most boys are active sportsmen with little time to get into mischief. In conventional accounts of a public school life, games are a means of sublimating the excessive energy of adolescent manhood. The parents of modern Etonians are more likely to be told that games sharpen the boys' competitive edge, teach them the value of teamwork, and instill in them that most English of virtues, how to lose gracefully. In the summer term, boys choose whether they will row or play cricket. They choose, in the school slang, whether to be a wet bob or a dry bob. These boys are about to be introduced to one of the most unstable vessels devised, the single scull. Few Etonians have rowed before they arrive at the school.
It's easy.
Their introduction to the sport, which is supervised by boys as well as beaks, can be an unforgiving one.
People who have a ducking first tend to do best in the end, because they get a bit more confidence after they've fallen in once and try a bit harder and concentrate more. Whereas if you don't fall in first time, you get overconfident. Then you fall in when you think you're rather good, and it puts you off for a rather long time.
I'll give you a rope, and we'll just see if we can tow you along to where the school is.
bubble's gone at the front.
I just suddenly fell in. Lost my balance and fell in.
Hey, what happened?
I fell off my seat and then I let go of yours, so I fell off.
How did you get off?
Don't ask. Please don't ask.
But you're dry.
That's one thing at least.
Is this your first time?
No, second.
Yes?
Yep.
And how did you like it?
That's brilliant. It's terrifying.
Those boys who best mastered its secrets can expect eventually to graduate to the Eight, the leading oarsmen of the school. But they have to work hard to keep their place in the boat.
Attention! Set! Go!
Hold tight.
In early summer, the Eight travel up to the Water Sports Centre at Nottingham to take part in the National School's rowing competition. It is the culmination of months of hard work.
Well, some of these boys have been training since they were, certainly training in a purposeful sense, since they were in E block in the second year. Of course, they started rowing, most of them, when they're in F block in the first year. So really, they've been training for 3 or 4 years, what you could say. So it's a long-term training program to build up both the state of the body and the state of the mind.
A warm-up run is followed by a brief moment of mental preparation, and then the conclusion of 4 years' training is upon them.
There doesn't seem to be any catching Eton, who continue to dominate, making 37, now perhaps 2.5 lengths ahead of Kingston Grammar School. But it's looking like a dogfight for the minor placings. Kingston Grammar School, look as though they'll get second. They've got half a length on St Paul's, and with Eton cruising towards the line, I'll hand you over to the start.
And was it worth all the training?
It's always worth the training. I mean, the stakes get higher and higher the more training you do. We've been training since September, and if you lose, you feel it. If you win, you just love it.
Eton does not have a conventional sports day or open day like other schools, but holds instead one of the biggest picnics imaginable, known as the 4th of June, but rarely held on that date. On the day before, the groundsmen put the finishing touches to already pristine playing fields. Lines are straightened, and the founder gets a polish. The school cannon, a frequent target of pranksters, receives a protective coat of oil.
We've had it painted orange and red in the past, but in the last couple of years, we've overcome that and stopped the boys from doing it by putting oil on it. And then if somebody gets up to the boys get up to any tricks, then we've got them because we know who's done it.
Beneath the busts of famous old Etonians, sixth form select rehearse the speeches they will recite the following day.
In Dr. War's wise hands, guided along.
The art school holds a preview party, unusually quiet this year on account of the alcohol-free wine.
When did you do this one?
Was it all part of that project with the self-portraits?
A pipe band, normally about 20 strong and made up of the scions of some of Scotland's oldest families, warm up before their performance in the tattoo. The pipe major realizes at the last moment that some of his troops are in danger of breaching the oldest of traditions.
Whip off the insulation.
Have you got anything on underneath?
I have got nothing on it. Whip off your insulation.
Things will go wrong if you're wearing
your insulation. Why?
You
went boxes.
Where are you going, Angus?
The offending underwear duly dispatched, the rehearsal is interrupted by the arrival of a helicopter. About 100 boys are in the cadet corps, rather less than in previous generations, but in line with the shrinkage of the armed forces.
What are they after aim for? What's that coming up?
They're for the provost's wife and the headmaster's wife. It's
going to
be
how are you going to deliver them?
As in the sort of, what's it called, milk tray ad. So we're going to present them after we've hit the deck.
Mm-hmm. The 4th of June is celebrated with flowers, and the first people to arrive in the morning are the flower sellers. Most of the boys buy carnations, which they sport proudly in their buttonholes as they wait on the pavements for their parents. But the rowers, who star later in the celebrated procession of boats, fill their hats with the blooms of summer.
How long have you been doing this?
Well, my father, he passed away in 1985, and he'd done it since he was 14. He was 75 when he died. 2 days before he died, he said, "Don't forget the boys are eating." He said, "I want you to carry on and do it for me." We've done it ever since. We still do it. We don't do it for the money. We do it because my father's asked me to keep the tradition up.
Each of the 25 houses holds its own garden party for parents and boys. By lunchtime, several thousand cars have gathered around the cricket field for the family picnics, which are the centerpiece of the day. The day was originally held in celebration of George III's birthday. While not greatly liked in America, he was much loved at Eton. After his death and the succession of George IV, whom the boys disliked intensely, Etonians doubled their efforts, making the day an even grander affair. After lunch, the rowers prepare their boats at Master's Boathouse.
Okay, stroke side ready, bow side and go.
As the crowds gather on the bank, rescue boats take their positions and the crews begin their procession downstream from the Windsor Castle end. That the crews wear goes back to Trafalgar, and the procession of boats itself puts the unsteadiness of the scull and oar to their ultimate test. Although you can wait many years before you see a crew fall in. Thirty years ago, a famous headmaster of Eton, Robert Burley, said that his ideal old Etonian would be the head of Harwell Research Station, who had learned Greek as a boy and now read the lesson at Harwell Parish Church. The chapel still occupies an important part in the life of the school, and the music played there offers a time for reflection. Modern Eton, like modern society, also wills itself to believe that social service can be an adequate substitute for religion.
Well, every Wednesday evening, a group of boys has gone down to visit the social club, Slough Camp, for the last 15 years. And they go down there in order to help entertain the 60 to 70 or 80 even, people of all ages, physically and mentally handicapped, who turn up there. And they do this through playing cards, dancing with them, just chatting with them, playing games. Right. It's very easy to go through Eton and, well, you can avoid making any sort of social commitment quite easily. You can't avoid now being aware of it. It's impossible for a boy, I think, really, to go through Eton now and be unaware of social problems of the world outside.
The members here, they wait week by week for the boys to arrive. And when the boys leave in June and they're not coming back again till September, I have all this anticipation week after week, because most of my members have no concept of time, because it brings such another dimension to their lives. Tonight you have seen, especially the ladies here, dancing with the Eton College boys, or playing games, table tennis as you saw. These ladies don't have the opportunity to mix with normal young people, and it's a great excitement to them. And the other thing that makes it especially good is that the boys that come here from Eton treat all of my men as an equal, and that doesn't really happen in the rest of the society.
Ironically, Eton today is probably less Philistine and more aesthetic, less narrow and more cultural than at any time in its history. Gladstone, whose room overlooked the churchyard, said of his time at Eton that the system of education there was quite without merit, apart from the rigor and relentless accuracy of the teaching. There is nothing mechanical about the teaching methods employed at Eton today.
Now, this book, Poems by John Keats, was really written by an adolescent. And here we've got Keats' death mask. It's quite remarkable. There are about three copies of this still in existence, of which probably this is the finest. Now, we'll be very careful and take it out. And we'll put it down so you can look upon the face of Keats.
Buenos dias, señores.
The school now teaches an immense range of languages. But not because languages are the keys with which to unlock the great civilizations of the world. Eton teaches languages because they make Etonians more employable.
So you need the general purpose apology in Japanese, don't you? Can you remember what that is?
Crystal Palace, che si chiama Chris Armstrong, sarà, giocherà in Italia l'anno prossimo e lo pagheranno 10 miliardi.
Koyis, Tayyib. أشوفكم بكرة إن شاء الله.
نعم.
نعم. مع السلامة. مع السلامة.
The reason we teach Arabic is that in 1986, a thing called the School's Arabic Project was founded with a view to introducing Arabic into independent schools, and we hope to maintain schools as well, simply because we felt there was a huge need for Arabic speakers to go out and get jobs in business and commerce.
Locate the centre.
One field in which the school would like to see more Etonians make their contribution is industry. It is a long-standing criticism of the public school system that it fosters an anti-industrial and anti-scientific ethos. Science teaching came to the public schools relatively late, and there was a particular bias against those aspects of it which bordered on mechanics or engineering. The fact that Eton now vaunts its pro-industrial and pro-scientific credentials is the clearest evidence that it has abandoned its traditional role as an institution for the gentrification of the business classes.
The School of Mechanics started in 1879, but it wasn't until 1973 that a full-time master was appointed to actually teach in the School of Mechanics. And the School of Mechanics then moved to this present building, and we really started links with industry. And it's the links with industry that make us the interface between Eton and the real world. Because a lot of Etonians still think that going into the city and making money in this way is better than actually working for a living and producing goods. And this is the thing we're trying to fight.
If Eton once taught that industrialism and science were pursuits alien to the English spirit, best left to Americans and Germans, it does so no longer. Eton's eye is now as firmly on foreign shores as it is on England's green and pleasant land.
I think Eton has shown that it is not just a school in Britain which is part of Europe, but it wants to be part of a much, much wider stage, and I suppose to put it in slightly trite terms, namely the world stage. And hence its links now with Asia, with China, with Japan, its international scholars, which have to come from throughout the world. They're not just coming from Eastern Europe, they're coming from throughout the world. And Eton's also had a very strong attachment with America for a number of years.
As part of the 1990 celebrations for the 550th anniversary of the school, The Provost and Fellows founded a number of international scholarships, which I now run, which means we can have up to six boys from various countries in the world on full scholarships or half scholarships, and the idea is to give them a feeling for English schools. And I'm planning this coming year to have two more Poles, a German, a Chinese boy, an American boy, and another Japanese. And I would very much like to get into the Palestinian-occupied territories as well. I think that can be done.
Also, it's not so elitist as it used to be, I think. I think it's supposed to be quite conservative, etc. But you can also meet supporters of the Socialist Workers' Party here. So it's not so pure upper class and conservative place. I was also surprised with the attitude towards me and etc. It was quite nice and friendly. And I was rather surprised that I couldn't find snobbery or something.
One feature that is key to Eton's academic success is that each boy not only has his own room, but he also has two tutors, one being known as a private tutor. The tutorials, which are known to Etonians as private business, take place in the hour between afternoon divs and supper.
You know, things like the French Revolution, king's dead, aristocracy's shut up, the churches closed, lots of people bleeding in the streets. This must have big causes. Is that true? Must they?
There are two.
At first, the privates offered a chance to relax. But as the years pass, boys use them to hone their ability to talk and to argue and develop an ease with adults. Mr. Kitson is a history beak. His pupils are greeted by the following message on his front door. Push open the door and walk in. If it is not on the latch, knock. There is no need to ring the bell, which is maddeningly strident. And for a dog who died long ago, but whose spirit lives on, if the dog is outside the door, kindly do not let him in. Guard against him artfully insinuating himself, or even in extremis trying to use force, for he is a tricky and determined character. Once they're behind the door, Mr. Kitson tells them that the television is the enemy of civilization.
Television, a ghastly machine.
Okay, let's go from air. One, four.
Eton's greatest strength, I think, is providing for each individual everything that he wants to do to the highest standard. Somebody came in and said they'd like to do play the steel drums. So I said, all right, if you can find two other boys who will like to play the steel drums, and you can tell me where I'm likely to find a teacher, and you can tell me where I'm likely to find a steel drum for you to learn on, then yes, I will. Next day, in he came. Two other names, a list of teachers, a list of manufacturers who provide steel drums. So I said, all right, and we've now got seven or eight boys who are doing the steel drums.
The day of the public school boy hero is over. The great thing about Eton being a large community which is taking people from many different spheres and encouraging them to perform well in many different spheres is the fact that your hero can only be a hero for the day. The school play was on this weekend. Today, tomorrow, for the rest of this week, boys will strut around being congratulated on what a wonderful school play, but by next week it will be the college concert. It will be the 11, it will be the 8 in Nottingham.
What we're doing is, I hope, sowing all sorts of seeds in the minds and spirits of the boys, which will blossom, some will, some won't, in the future, and it blossom in different ways. I believe that they're lucky and privileged to be here, that we try to provide a centre of excellent education. Excellence without arrogance was what I said would be my slogan when I became provost, and what I hope that we produce. But if they can, with excellence and without arrogance, go into every field of activity, that, I believe, can only be beneficial for the country as a whole.
In the past, Eton was perceived to be insular, and its distinctive esprit de corps only heightens that misconception. It is, however, this very individual spirit, born of a common bond, that guarantees Etonians are not insular.
If you say that Etonians are complacent, there must be a lot of truth in it. The difficulty is to be sure whether in any educational system you can edit it out. After all, they need to be given confidence, they need to be given some sense of their own judgment, they need to be given some sense that they count. And this is bound to mean that some people won't look beyond that. If it's a good school, there must be quite a lot of subversion, quite a lot of undermining of what they think they're at, so that they come out of the place open-minded. Now, I don't know how many do come out genuinely open-minded. I would have thought that one would like to think that the people do, that they are willing to accept completely different backgrounds, completely different ideas from the ones they've come up with. The best ones do.
I think any educational institution is interested in individuals. It wants those individuals to be themselves, to find themselves, to fulfill themselves, to be happy about being themselves. But at the same time, it wants individual folk to rise above themselves, to do things that they never dreamt of doing or never thought that they could do. So it's partly a question of being what you are, partly a question of daring to be more than what you thought you could be.
Whatever paths Etonians choose to follow, they all take leave of the school at 18 by signing a leaving book. Within the same tradition, new boys sign an enrollment book. As Prince William went to sign in on his first day, joining the many tens of thousands who've done so before, he passed the founder's statue, offering for a brief moment a rare glimpse of once and future kings. If dreams can be combined with duty, then Prince William's chances of a happy and effective adult life will owe much to the foundation that he is about to receive over the next 5 years. The school has amply demonstrated that it is large enough to cope with all individuals and to find something in which each of them can succeed. The privacy it offers, the responsibility with which he is entrusted, the fellowship of other boys, and the easy relationship it offers between boys and beaks should, we hope, be sufficient to withstand some of the pressures that most 13-year-old boys are never required to undergo.